Talk to you this morning. Of course, it's Resurrection Sunday and all that, but we've been in a series called Timeless, and we've been looking at stories from the Old Testament, how they have timeless lessons that go along with those stories. 3 weeks ago, we looked at Rahab and risky obedience, how that she put herself at risk to obey God that she didn't really know and chose to live with him rather than die with her culture. And then we looked at David when he had probably his worst day ever. His son had deposed him, was trying to kill him, and he goes out of this. He's running for his life, barefoot with his head covered, and they come upon a guy from Saul's family who is cursing and swearing at him and yelling obscenities and bad things at him, throwing rocks at him. And David's mighty man says, "Let's just go over there and decapitate that guy." And David said, "No. Maybe the Lord is doing this." So in humility, he took the abuse from this man and said, maybe the Lord will turn that into something good in my life. Then we looked last week at Korah and a band of people who thought that they could determine how and where and what is supposed to be done rather than God. They just knew a little bit more than God, and so they decided they were going to do things that weren't designated for them. And in that event, it didn't turn out well for them. And we learned the timeless truth, that honest worship is what God wants. And honest worship is a matter of the heart. Now hear me. This is serious. You came into this building this morning. I know it's Easter, and a lot of folks are here that we don't see very often. And some are old friends that go to other churches, and I'm not belittling you. I'm talking to every person sitting in this room. When you walk through those doors, you should have a conscious awareness that you are presenting yourself before a living God. He is the focus of what we're doing here this morning. Not me, not you, it's him. And so in our hearts, if we're honest before him, we'll come in and say, God, I'm here to see you. I am here to worship you. I am here to hear from you. And just pray right now and say, God, open my ears of my heart, open my mind to truth, and just really speak to me. Now this morning we're going to talk about snatching life from the jaws of death, because we're going to talk a little bit about Jonah. I don't know how many of you are fishermen. I know a couple guys here love to fish. I enjoy catching fish, not fishing for fish. And so, therefore, I rarely go fishing because the whole adventure to me is I just want to sit there and catch them. I don't want to wait for hours for them to bite. And so I'm not much of a fisherman. And I don't know how many of you have ever seen the videos of the upper Midwest now. We had somebody who thought it would be a good idea to introduce into our rivers some oriental carp, silver carp, they're called. And so they introduced them into our rivers. They're not native to our country, and they have taken over. And if you've ever watched these videos, you probably, like my youngest grandson, just laughed your head off, because they go down this river in a motorboat, and in front and behind them, these fish get so agitated, they're leaping out of the water. They literally leap into boats. In fact, a sad thing, one guy was killed by one when he's driving his boat and the fish hit him in the head and broke his neck. I mean, they drive with windshields up. Sometimes they're trying to catch him in nets when they go by. You know, they're trying to bag him like you're playing highlight or something. They will use ball bats and try it. They're just everywhere, just leaping into the boat. And when Revy would watch those with me, he would just roar with laughter because the fish would just leap right into the boat. Now, that's my kind of fishing. I have no idea if they're good to eat, but that has nothing to do with my message either. I want to talk about Jonah. And there was a young girl in elementary school who, in her art class, was drawing a picture, and she drew a picture of a whale with Jonah in it. And her teacher looked at her, "You don't really believe the story of Jonah in a whale surviving, do you?" And the little girl just said, "Yes, I do." And the teacher said, "How in the world could that happen?" She says, I don't know. But when I get to heaven, I'll ask him. And the teacher looked at her and says, what if he's not there? Without batting an eye, she says, you ask him. I love innocence so much. Have you ever been asked to do something really, really, really unpleasant? I think probably most of us have. But if you're asked to do something scary and unpleasant and had to do it, then you might be a little aware of what's happening to Jonah in the story. Few stories in the Bible invoke as much criticism as this story. It's interesting to me. Those of us who, like the little girl, believe the story, we have no problem with it. It just seems silly for anybody to take objection to the story. You're in good company if you happen to believe that it actually happened, because Jesus believed it actually happened. And anytime I can line up with him, I'm a happy guy. In fact, it became a central teaching point in Jesus' earthly ministry when he was being pushed by his enemies to provide some level of authority for what he was doing. We want to know that you have the authority to say and do the things you're doing. Show us some kind of sign. Now, think about this for a second. Jesus raised the dead, made the blind see, made the lame walk, and healed all manner of diseases. And these idiots are looking at him and saying, we want to see a sign from you that says you have the authority to do what you're doing. Jesus told them, you won't have one except Jonah. Now, it is interesting, if you're at all a reader of the Bible and you read through the New Testaments about Jesus, you will find that he refers to only four prophets while he was on earth. Just four Old Testament prophets. Jonah is one. Elijah is one. Elisha is one, not the same people. Elijah, Elisha. And Isaiah is one. Since he only referred to four of the Old Testament prophets, that gives Jonah some street creds here. And so, according to Jonah, God told him, you have to go to the great city of Nineveh and cry against it. Now, Nineveh was one of the oldest cities post-flood. If you go back to, don't do it right now. If you go back to Genesis chapter 10, you will find the story of a man named Nimrod. And Nimrod was the very first empire builder. He built an empire. He had the first empire. And he built cities in his empire. And Nimrod built the city of Nineveh. It's on the Tigris River, just not very far from modern-day Baghdad are the ruins of Nineveh today. So it was in the empire of Jonah's day called Assyria, and these people were bad people, brutal people. They had harassed and hurt Israel over and over and over again, and Jonah wasn't very fond of them. They were scary people. In fact, it's a very real possibility that as Jonah's going into the main citadel city, the city, like Dallas, has suburbs all around it, the main citadel city on the main street leading into town, that on either side of the road, down that road, would be impaled people, either totally hanging there on sticks or having been decapitated and had their heads there. That was the manner of the Ninevites, because they were brutal people. They wanted to scare their enemies when they were heading in that direction. Now, Jonah didn't want to go, but that none of those were the reasons he didn't want to go. It isn't that they were scary. It isn't that they were brutal. It isn't that he didn't want to have to walk down the street and see all of those bodies hanging on sticks. It was he didn't want to tell them that God was coming after them, because he thought that if he told them God is coming after them, they were going to repent. And if they repented, the God he knew and served would spare them, and Jonah didn't want them spared. Now think about that for a minute. Are there people in your life that you may not say, go to hell. That's what you mean. That's what's in your heart. I don't want them in heaven with me. I don't want them to receive the grace of God. I don't want them to be pardoned of their sins. Their sins are too grievous. Their sins are too personal against me. God, don't, yeah. This city was extremely large. Although the main citadel only occupied about 8 miles in circumference, of the city was huge. Around it, there were a lot of people there. It took him 3 days to go from one side to the other. And you have to remember now, he's not just walking straight through. He's walking and stopping and talking, and he walks and he stops and he talks and he walks and and all the time he's preaching the message that God gave him. But he didn't go at first, did he? He ran away. Went to a ship down at Joppa, went into the water, and God says, you're not going anywhere. He shook up the whole sea. And to make a long story short, Jonah simply told him, you better throw me in the ocean or the Mediterranean Sea. If you don't, you're going to all die. They didn't want to do it, but they had to do it. And so they threw him into the water. And I love this part. There was a fish ready to swallow Jonah. In fact, the scripture says there was a prepared fish. Now, I don't know in my Bible study if this meant God created a specific fish for this to happen, or he designated a particular fish to be at that point. I wish he'd do that for me when I was fishing. Have you ever seen the cartoon where Moses and Elijah are fishing together? And Elijah's got his hook in the ground, but Moses parts the water, so it's just sitting on the ground. This fish was in the exact place it needed to be at the exact time Jonah's being pitched out of a ship into the water. And so when he hits the water, he is swallowed by a fish. By the way, it's not a whale. The Hebrew and the Greek both talk about a big fish. Now, don't get stuck here. You could spend a whole lot of time. There are fish that are large enough to swallow people whole. Lots of them. And so don't get stuck there worried about that. Now, you can argue about what happened after he was swallowed, because there's a couple things that come to mind. How does a person survive in the belly of a fish? We would say, not possible. It's not possible. It's impossible. 72 hours, not going to happen. We're stuck with the story. And the story says he was 3 days and three nights, 72 hours, in the belly of a fish. So only one of two things has to happen. Number one, God miraculously spared his life while he was in the fish's belly. That he survived the entire 72 hours because God made it happen. The other answer is he died and God brought him back to life. There's the only two ways to look at that story. I personally am of the persuasion that Jonah was alive and well in the body of the fish for 72 straight hours. He must have smelled really nice when he came out. And by the way, may I say this? Is either one of those too hard for God? No. I mean, he stood at the tomb of one of his best friends on earth 4 days after he died and says, Lazarus, come out. And out waddled Lazarus, all wrapped up in grave clothes. It's me. I'm here. If he can do that, he can keep a guy alive 3 days, 72 hours in a fish. Not a big deal for me. Don't let it strangle you. So Jonah goes through the whole city and he says, God is ticked at you and he's coming after you. That's a story of judgment. That's a message of judgment. You have hit the limit, folks. Your sin has filled up. And God is ready to tip your cup over and eliminate all of you. And Jonah was enjoying that message every step he took. Be careful. People without Jesus Christ are going to go to hell. That is the truth. But you and I should not delight in telling them that. It should break our heart. It should bring us to tears that we have to share with somebody that unless you turn to Christ and repent of your sins and claim Him as your Savior, you are going to spend an eternity in lostness and hell. Jonah was enjoying the message. Well, his worst nightmare came true. The whole town from the top to the bottom just repented. Put on sackcloth, been on their face before the God who brought the message of judgment. There's a reason, maybe. A couple of things that happened in Nineveh leading up to this. And just before that, not too long before this, there had been a total eclipse. That may have shaken them up somewhat, you know, wondering what is going to go on. But the truth is, nobody repents of their sin without the help of the Holy Spirit. I mean, the Holy Spirit has to be moving in people's lives, and the truth has to be proclaimed in order for people to repent, and that's exactly what happened. And so God deals with Jonah about his anger about that. But here's the point. We're going to switch gears now. I want Matthew chapter 12, verses 38 to 41. It says this. Then some of the scribes and Pharisees answered, saying, "Teacher, we wish to see a sign from you." But he answered them. I want to stop here for a second because I want you, if you're a sign-seeking group, I want you to listen to this. "An evil and adulterous generation seeks for a sign. But no sign will be given to you except the sign of the prophet Jonah. For just as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. The men of Nineveh will rise up in judgment with this generation and condemn it, for they repented at the preaching of Jonah. Behold, something greater than Jonah is here." Heavenly Father, today in heaven, we ask that you would have your Spirit move mightily in our lives. Every one of us, each one of us, need you. We need to know what it is that you want us to hear and learn. We need to know where it is you want us to go. We need you in our lives. For some, Father, they walked in here alive and well, but dead spiritually. They have never trusted your Son, Jesus Christ, and they need that today. For some of us, we have known your Son for a long time, and yet our spiritual life is as good as dead. We have no zeal. We have no obedience. We have no real joy about what we're doing, and we need you to raise us to new life today. I thank you that you have kept our church alive for 80-plus years. We seek to know you. We seek to share you. We seek to follow you. And because of that, you have allowed this church to be alive and well for these years. And we thank you for that. Now today, you direct our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Easter Sunday, or Resurrection Day, for those of us who claim the risen Savior, is in fact the best day on our calendar. And it's about so much more than bunnies, eggs, and fine dress, right? Don't get me wrong. Right out here in this yard and out in another, there are plastic eggs everywhere for our kids to go chase down. And I have it by good authority that the Easter bunny is going to show up too. If you enjoy doing those kinds of things, then just have a good time. If you don't, that's all right. You don't have to. But that isn't what Resurrection Sunday is about. What Resurrection Sunday is about is the resurrection of Jesus Christ from among the dead, and it changed everything. Babies are born all the time. I know there's a song that a baby changes everything. Every parent in here knows exactly what that means. Whew. But babies are born all the time. Jesus was born in a manger. We celebrate that at Christmas. We talk about that. But babies were born all the time. But no one has ever gone into a grave and come out on their own except for Jesus. His death, burial, and resurrection changes everything. And you and I need to focus on that. Here's Jonah in total rebellion to God, going the opposite direction that God had told him to go, running and hiding away from God, and his penalty for his rebellion was death, actually. Whether he's alive or in the fish or not, guess what? He's as good as dead. There isn't a whole lot you're going to do from the belly of a fish. But God took him and raised him up or moved him out and said, go do what I told you to do. It's more than just a second chance. We are not in the second chance business. This church isn't in the second chance business. This church is in the business of resurrecting people from the dead. This church is in the business of having new life. When we baptize a convert, when we baptize somebody who has given their life to Jesus Christ, the words we say is buried in the likeness of his death and raised to walk in newness of life. When I got saved, I was raised to walk in newness of life. I have Jesus Christ living in me, and I am to live a new kind of life every day. It's not just a second chance. You can have a second chance and fail miserably. Reincarnation is the most miserable idea anybody ever came up with. Who wants another chance to live in this crummy world, failing all the time? You get a second chance to fail, a third chance to fail, a fourth chance to fail, a fifth chance to fail. That's not what God offers you. God offers you victory. He offers you new life. He raises you to walk in newness of life, even while you're still on earth. And then, praise God, one day and soon, we're going to be walking the street of gold in heaven. What a dreary thought. Same old life over and over and over again. Shirley MacLaine must have something wrong with her. She wanted to do that for hundreds of years? Oh my gosh. What an existence. I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. Because he lives, I live. I can face tomorrow because I know he's alive. That's what he gives us. Jesus isn't in the second chance business. Amazing grace isn't a second chance song. Amazing grace is, I was blind, but now I see. I was lost, but now I'm found. I have new life. And every person who's ever been given the grace of God in their lives know exactly what it means to be a worm like me or a wretch like me. How God could love me. We just sang a song in which the lyric said, how could God love me, the sinner that I am? But he did. Amazing grace. Now hear this, because our story is about judgment. If you take judgment out of the gospel, there is no reason for the gospel. I'm going to say it again. I worked on this all week. If you take judgment out of the gospel, there is no reason for the gospel. If you and I are not sinners, condemned sinners, living under the judgment of God, then grace means nothing. See, when the song Amazing Grace was written, as that little sonnet, he knew exactly what he was talking about. He knew what sin had done to his life. He knew what sin hold had on him. And he knew what it meant to be free from that hold. So I have to tell you, not happily, but I have to tell you that as you sit here today, if you have never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life, then you are condemned already, according to John chapter 3. If you don't believe that Jesus is God in the flesh who was raised from the dead, you are condemned already. And not only that, you're spiritually dead where you sit. You don't need somebody to give you another chance. You need somebody to give you life. The book of Ephesians says we were dead in our trespasses and sin, but God quickened us. He gave us new life. New life changes everything for us. In Romans chapter 10, verse number 9, if you confess with your mouth the Lord, Jesus is Lord, by the way, that means Jehovah God from the Old Testament, and believe in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead, you will be saved. I'll be so bold as to tell you that unless you believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ from among the dead, you are not saved. I know that's hard to hear, but that's what it is. The message of judgment is we are lost without hope unless Christ moves into our life. That's what we share here at this church. And we do it with love and kindness and mercy, but we have to share that message. We sing a song sometimes. Christ arose, up from the grave he arose. I love that song. Because that song told me that he came out of the grave with great power. Romans chapter 1, verse number 4, declared to be the Son of God with power by the resurrection from among the dead. What does new life mean? I'm dead in my sin, and then all of a sudden, because of Jesus Christ, I'm alive in Christ Jesus. I get new life. I get new life for today, I get new life for tomorrow, and I get new life for eternity. But it's more than just that. Remember what Jesus said? Jesus said, I am come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. See, it's more than just an insurance policy against hell. It is a new life that you get here. An abundant life, a joyful life, a thrilling life, a life that has purpose and meaning, a life that impacts others as well as yourself. The message is simple. If you come to Christ, he will give you new life. So let me ask you something. He's not just in the life-giving business. Remember, I told you Lazarus was dead in the grave, and he brought him back just like that, 4 days dead. His sisters even said, man, don't open that tomb. He's going to stink like crazy. Jesus, I'm not worried about that. Lazarus, come out here. Now, let me ask you something. If he could do that, and you're sitting here today, and inside of your heart, your whole spiritual life is dead. You're going through the motions. You're saying all the things you need to say, but inside of you, you are just dry and withered and dead. I got news for you. Jesus is in the new life business. You can come into this room with a dead spiritual life, drained and dry, and Jesus can give you a fresh new breath of life. He'll do that for you. He loves doing that. You just got to admit to him what's happening in your life. Married couples come in this church all the time. And thank God for that. You may be sitting here and your marriage is about ready to just implode. It happens, folks. You're looking at that person and you say, I'd just soon strangle them as kiss them. I want you to know something. Jesus Christ can bring a dead marriage back to life. And don't you try to convince me differently, because I know what he did for us. He can do that. You got a career that's all dried up. You got a career that's sucking the life out of you. Maybe it's because your attitude towards your career is wrong. Maybe it's because you're in the wrong career. I don't know, but here's what I do know. Jesus isn't just a Sunday Lord. He's a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday Lord too. He has as much interest in where you go to church as where you go to work. He cares as much about your life at school as he does at home or in church. And if you're dragging, if you're drained, if you're dreary, if you're just dying where you are, then I'm asking you to get on your face before God and say, God, you got to do something, or otherwise I'm just going to dry up and blow away. He can do it. But the greatest thing about Easter Sunday to me is this. August 37 years ago, on August the 6th, my dad died. Stood around his bed, watched him breathe his last. He was at my ordination, which we moved up because of his cancer, but he never got to share in any of my ministry stuff. I could never call him up and say, Dad, you're never going to believe where I'm at now, what's happening now. Because cancer took him away from us. You know what this Sunday says to me? He's not dead. He's more alive today than he's ever been. He is alive and well because he put his faith and trust in the risen Lord. And all of us in this room who have had to stand around the bedside of people we love, who know Jesus Christ, and watch the life drain out of that physical body, we have the guaranteed proof that because he lives, our family lives too. And you might think 37 years ago, he's probably getting tired of waiting on me, but I want you to know what eternity is. Eternity isn't a whole bunch of days laid together. Eternity is one day where the sun never sets, where darkness never comes. So it's just like the day he left us. He's waiting for us in heaven. My mother now has joined him. I don't know about you, but there have been times in my spiritual life where my spiritual life was sucked right out of me. What I like best about God is he never slaps you around about that. You go to him and say, God, I'm in trouble. I'm hurting. I'm dragging. If you don't do something, I'm quitting. And he doesn't say, John, I'm sick and tired of hearing you say that. He gives you new life. He gives you new hope. He gives you new passion. Life is going to throw us things. It's going to happen. There is nothing we can do about it. It is the way life works. But Jesus told his disciples the night he was betrayed, in the world you're going to have a lot of trouble, but be of good cheer, because I have overcome the world. I hope he's overcome your world. Heavenly Father, I thank you today.